So very warm welcome to everyone for being with us today at this special panel session on account of the World Food Day. So nutrition is one of the key priority areas for CIIF, for which we work closely with the government, development sector partners, as well as industry to create standards and partnership to scale and strengthen nutrition delivery. Therefore, I would like to take this opportunity to welcome you all to our collaborative efforts with Quaker in organizing this special panel session on account of World Food Day as a culmination of our long month initiative with series of nutrition sessions in spreading nutrition awareness and knowledge across different cohorts, as well as live demonstration by chefs on quick healthy recipes. So let me take a few moments to thank and introduce you all with our much experienced panelists for today who have invested their precious time to share their insights in today's session. So we have with us Ms. Inoshi Sharma. She is the Executive Director at FSSAI, very involved with leading the social behavioral change and communication, Eat Right India initiatives, and extending support to scaling up fortification across the country. She has in the past also worked as Director, National Health Mission, overseeing adolescent health amongst other areas. Ma'am, thank you so much for joining us today. And we have Mr. Manoj Sarkar. He is the bronze medalist, Tokyo 2020 Paralympics men's badminton SL3, honored with Arjun Award for Para Badminton 2018, silver medal at the Para Asian Games in Incheon 2014. Manoj's condition was triggered by wrongful medication when he was just a year old. He is a huge inspiration to the youth of our country. And he has made all of us very proud. And we are indeed blessed to have him with us today. He has been playing badminton since the age of 5 and is actively engaged in coaching young aspiring badminton players. We welcome you, Manoj, with us today. We also have with us Dr. Jagmeet Padan. She's an eminent nutritionist, national president, Indian Dietetic Association, Principal and Professor, Department of Nutrition and Dietetics at SNDT College, Mumbai. She's a gold medalist and recipient of many prestigious awards. She's a member of National Steering Committee of NetProFan, FSSAI, Government of India, with more than 50 publications in international and national peer-reviewed journals. We welcome you, ma'am. And we have this very young ambassador fellow with us, Ms. Priya Prakash. She's a healthcare entrepreneur and the founder and CEO of HealthSet Go. She's a global shaper with the World Economic Forum, taking up many socially impactful projects for rural India. Priya is a TEDx speaker, CrossFit L1 trainer, and an avid health blogger with a passion for Olympic weightlifting. So that makes a very good combination that we have Priya and we have Mr. Manoj Sarkar with us to drive this health and fitness agenda together. And then we have Ms. Pavitra Singh. She's currently heads the HR for PepsiCo India. With 19 years of work experience leading large teams across geography, she has held leadership positions across a variety of roles in India and other markets. Prior to joining PepsiCo, she has worked with American Express and Fair Isaac. She has been recognized in ET's Women Ahead list of 2016 as one of corporate India's fastest rising women leaders. And finally, to facilitate today's conversation, we have Ms. Vinita Bali, Chairperson, CII National Committee on Nutrition and member of the Board of Governor of Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore. She brings a global and pragmatic perspective to strategic marketing, innovation and operations, having worked across countries and continents with responsibility for global and regional roles. She was among 27 global leaders appointed by UN to help improve the maternal and child health as part of scaling up nutrition initiative. She has been recognized in forums globally and has many awards to her credit. So with this, I welcome all of you to today's session and to all the attendees also, I welcome all of you to be a part of this event with us today. So before we start and pitch in with the conversation, to give you a context setting, we are just going to take you through a video where the Quaker PepsiCo has done a survey highlighting the ongoing trends or how COVID has impacted and changed the dietary lifestyles. So can we have the video, please? Thank you.
India, through its brand Quaker, partnered with Euromonitor International to conduct a survey on the changing lifestyle and dietary habits of urban Indians post the COVID-19 pandemic. Did you know, during the pandemic, 49% urban millennials had breakfast late, while 44% millennials skipped it altogether. 71% urban Indians were concerned about their weight, with many having tried multiple trending diets only to end up binge eating and experiencing weight gain. An increased concern about immunity led to it becoming one of the five concerns of urban Indians during the pandemic, with 40% food choices driven by the need to have immunity. These significant changes to our dietary and lifestyle habits brought on by the pandemic calls for a credible conversation on health to understand what it means to be the real fit. PepsiCo India through...
So thank you so much for the video. And with this, we build in and take this forward. And now I hand it over to Ms. Bali now to facilitate the session forward.
Thank you very much, Richa, and a very warm welcome to all of you, our panelists, as well as other people who have joined this conversation. We will all have an opportunity to participate. And before I begin, just a few house rules, which will make it very easy for everybody. Because there are so many of us on this call, may I request everybody to please mute themselves and only unmute yourself when you are speaking. That way the quality of audio improves for everybody. This is a 1.5 hour session, so there will be plenty of time for everybody who is in the audience to ask any questions of any of the panelists. And we will do that after about 45 minutes or so, once we've had a conversation with all of the panelists. And just lastly, you might see me disappearing a little bit early. That is because I have another board meeting, but the session will continue. And between Meetu and Richa from CII, they will facilitate the session quite seamlessly. So this is going to be conversational. And part of the challenge of an online platform is how do you keep the conversation going, especially when you're talking one-on-one and we are seeing one person talk. We'll attempt to do our best. So let me start off with the results that we've seen from the survey, which Quaker and Euromonitor conducted. And let me start with asking Dr. Jagmeet Madan, who is the real nutritionist in the sense of having studied nutrition more than the rest of us. What does this say? And for all of us, can you just highlight for us what is the importance of breakfast? What are the implications? So this is data. It tells me 49% are eating late, 44% are skipping altogether. But what is the implication of this? So the question is, so what if I'm having breakfast late or if I'm skipping it? What is the role of breakfast in our health and nutrition? And what are the implications of skipping it or having it late?
So at the outset, thank you very much, Vinita, Meetu, Richa, the entire group, Ms. Inoshi, Mr. Manoj. I think it's such a joy to be a part of this conversation. I think my opening sentence would be that millennials, to my mind, which has been the focus of the study, which has been published, are the most important group to be considered to understand the meaning of real fitness. Because if we are talking about fitness, fitness from a nutritionist perspective is not stepping on a weighing scale. So today, fitness is your body composition. So we talk the language of what is your body fat percentage? What is your lean body mass? You know, so it's not an increase or decrease in weight, which actually defines if you are fit or no. And to my mind, I think it's my dream as a nutritionist to see the millennials of this country, all the young adults of this country, to get this real fitness. And it is possible. There is data, you know, which we have published now, and we have published even in the past, that there is a direct correlation between the quality of nutrition and your body composition. And in addition to that, the lifestyle factors. So coming back to your question of breakfast. So breakfast eating is a part of a lifestyle, you know, it's a lifestyle factor, which the millennials may underscore and may think that it may or may not be important. But scientifically, I'm talking from the science perspective, and we have data to say, not only this data we published now, even in the past we published data to clearly indicate that breakfast skippers have a high body fat content. Okay, the moment you are skipping your breakfast, you are skipping one of the most important meal of the day, because we must understand that physiologically in the morning, the first part of the morning, you know, your hormonal profile is very different. So to blunt the increase of the catabolic hormone, to get, you know, what should I say, a very healthy, conducive environment, we need to break our fast, you know, with food, which should be taken definitely before a certain time. I cannot say that I eat at 1 o'clock and that's my breakfast, because, you know, I mean, there's no defined definition, but we normally say that you should eat your breakfast definitely before 10:30 or 11 o'clock. You know, that's the first quarter of the day. So why breakfast? Because, like I told you, that there is data. I'm not only explaining science, but I'm supporting my statements with data to say that eating breakfast, you know, provides us with that head start in the day, the energy, especially coming from quality nutrients. It's not that we have bread jam as breakfast. So that's also not a good idea. I think when we say breakfast, we want the millennials to understand the importance of eating breakfast, you know, in a stipulated period of the first half of the day, and eating quality for the breakfast. Now, when I say quality, we are looking at definitely good quality protein going in breakfast. We are looking at whole grain cereals going in the breakfast. We are also looking at good quality fats, you know, going in the cereal. Now, when I'm talking about these three important pillars or verticals going in the breakfast, it means I'm enabling my body to get a sustained release of energy. That is one. So my highs and lows are very, very less. I am energetic right at the beginning of the day. And there is study to show that if we consume breakfast regularly, you know, we gain on the second meal effect. There is science to say that people who skip breakfast tend to overeat in other meals. And also the people who skip breakfast cannot make up for that 25 or 30% of nutrient intake, what they have missed in the day. So I think the point which we are driving is there is no harm in anybody following a regime of eating. You know, you may want to eat in a window of 8 hours or 10 hours, you know, that's also fine. But as long as you are respecting the circadian rhythm, which is very important for the body, that means there is a place for the breakfast, there is a place for the lunch, there is a place for a good snack, and there is a place for an early dinner. So if we are closing our shop early and we are starting our day with breakfast, I think we are gaining in terms of our energy levels, in our improving our body composition, and also preventing the second meal effect, and getting a very, very good hormonal profile, which will prevent the fat accumulation.
Thank you. I think it's a very good start to understanding the importance of breakfast. Before I come to Manoj, since we've been talking about fitness and so on, let me go to Inoshi and ask a question, which is that, FSSAI for a significant period of time has made a lot of effort in the Eat Right initiative. So you've got Eat Right campuses and so on. Can you very quickly say what has been the focus of Eat Right so far? And what change, if any, or what improvement or enhancement, if any, can we expect as we go forward, as more and more of these insights are available on, how people are eating, how they are consuming, what they are consuming, etc. So, Inoshi?
Thank you so much. As part of the Eat Right initiative, like all of you are aware, we have broadly three pillars which, cover the maximum gamut of the food area, if I were to say. The core focus, of course, is on eating safe, following safety and hygiene parameters, because that is of utmost importance. No matter how healthy or nutritious your food is, but if it's not prepared in a safe or a hygienic condition, it will not give you the nutrients. The second thing, of course, is eating healthy, which means having a balanced diet, eating local and seasonal, incorporating some fortified staples, and reducing the foods which are high in salt, fat, and sugar. And eating sustainable is, conserving water, reducing the use of plastics or of used cooking oil. So by these three pillars, what we really hope at FSSAI is not only to address the issue of malnutrition, undernutrition, but also of NCDs and also of foodborne illnesses. That having been said, the Eat Right initiative can be adopted in any of the settings that we can think of, wherever food is served. So one of the programs, like you rightly mentioned, is the Eat Right campus. So the first question comes is, how do you define a campus? Any place where any person is spending a reasonable amount of time of their entire day can become a campus. So it could be a hospital, a railway station, an airport, an office, be a corporate office or a government office, a school, a college, even jails for that instance, an Anganwadi center, any of those places where people are working and food is served. So it's not just about ensuring that the food that you receive during those working hours or in the canteen that you are having is healthy, but what kind of information do you also get while you are working or at that place about a healthy diet? What is an overall healthy diet and how you can incorporate it in your own lives every day? So when you go back home, how do you make sure that what you are eating is also healthy? If you want to indulge, do you put some sort of a restriction? Because at FSSAI, we never say that any one food is good or bad. Food is not bad per se. It's the amount of food that you have, the time at which you have, and the lack of physical activity, reduced amount of sleep, increased amount of television or computer screens, and wrong eating practices, basically. So while you're watching your phone or your computer or your TV, you're eating mindlessly. Those are things that we encourage people not to do. So the Eat Right initiative, to that extent, is something where we are encouraging people to adopt, which traditionally we were following. Just about, say, 40 or 30 years back, I would say, people were not so exposed to processed food or bombarded with advertisements about looking cool when you're having some type of food and how, it is not so cool to have your Lokki Tinda Parval. So those kind of things are something that we want people to, change.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. So Manoj, this is a good time to ask you, humne bahut suna nutrition, exercise, to be active, as Dr. Madan just shared with us. That is what you need to get your energy for the full day. So, first of all, hamari sabki taraf se aapko bahut congratulations for bringing so much pride to India through the medal that you won in Tokyo. तो आप हमें बताएं कि आपकी जो रोज का रेजिमेन है प्रैक्टिस का, सुबह उठ के क्या करते हैं उसमें, हाउ डू यू थिंक अबाउट न्यूट्रिशन, कब खाना चाहिए, कैसे खाना चाहिए, और बाकी जो फिजिकल एनर्जी, फिजिकल एक्टिविटी आप करते हैं, और एक एंड में अगर जो मिलेनियल्स हैं, जो आज के यंग लोग हैं, उनको अगर आप एक सलाह दें अपने एक्सपीरियंस से, तो वो क्या होगी?
थैंक यू मैम, थैंक यू सो मच. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल बहुत आज मुझे लगता है कि इतने सारे मीटिंग्स मैंने करे हैं, सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट मीटिंग यही है. मैं एक छोटी सी स्टोरी बताता हूँ इसके पीछे, मुझे लगता है वो आंसर सब कुछ हो जाएगा सारे मिलेनियल्स के लिए. वो ये है, मैं एक प्रोग्राम में था और उन्होंने एक क्वेश्चन पूछा मुझसे कि आपके लिए क्या सबसे ज्यादा इम्पोर्टेंट है. तो उसमें ऑप्शंस थे, आपका कोच, आपके फिजिकल ट्रेनर, आपके फाइनेंशियल सपोर्ट एज अ स्पोर्ट्स मैन, आपके डाइटिशियंस मतलब न्यूट्रिशन जो है वो है. तो लिस्ट वाइज फोर लिस्ट थे, तो सबने मोस्टली टाइम सबने लिखा कि हमारे मेरे कोच ही सब कुछ है. तो लास्ट में जब न्यूट्रिशन आए और उन्होंने आके एक ही क्वेश्चन पूछा, ठीक है काम करते हैं आपका खाना बंद कर देते हैं आज, और आज का दिन खाना मत खाइए और कल खेल लीजिए. तो दैट इज द पॉइंट कि उस दिन हमें समझ में आया कि बिना इसके हमारा इंजन चलना ही नहीं है.
बिल्कुल.
मोस्ट थिंग जब हम लोग खेलते हैं तो सबसे ज्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट रहता है सबसे ज्यादा, क्योंकि अगर आप खाते ही नहीं है, अगर आप सही चीजें नहीं खाएंगे और सही टाइमिंग से नहीं लेंगे, तो मैम फ्रेंकली बताऊं एज अ स्पोर्ट पर्सन, आपकी बॉडी फिर भी हो सकता है 10% यूज हो जाए, चल जाए, बट ओवरऑल आपका माइंड बिल्कुल वर्क नहीं करेगा. तो हमारे पूरी बॉडी का जो पूरा प्रोसेस है वो मतलब टोटल पार्ट, मतलब मैं कहूंगा कि 1% नहीं 100% पार्ट हमारे न्यूट्रिशन के ऊपर है, हमारे डाइट के ऊपर है. अगर हम वो फॉलो नहीं करते हैं तो लिटरली मतलब सब कुछ खत्म हो जाएगा. आपके फिजिकल तो होना ही होना है, आपका माइंड भी ब्लॉक हो जाएगा.
बहुत बहुत अच्छा कहा आपने. एक्चुअली बहुत सिंपल से तरीके से यू नो यू मेड अस ऑल अंडरस्टैंड कि द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ न्यूट्रिशन. तो एक क्वेश्चन फॉलो अप मैं आपसे पूछना चाहूंगी. जैसे आप अभी ओलंपिक्स के लिए तैयारी कर रहे थे, तो मेरी असम्पशन है और हम सबकी असम्पशन हो सकती है कि उस दौरान आपने काफी प्रैक्टिस की होगी, तो उसमें आप हमें बताएंगे कि आपके जो न्यूट्रिशन में क्या बदलाव आया, क्या आपसे कहा गया, क्या आपने खास खास किया, जो कि बाकी भी लोग, हम ओलंपिक मेडल तो नहीं जीत सकते लेकिन तंदुरुस्ती का मेडल तो हम सब जीत सकते हैं.
एग्जैक्टली मैम, इसमें जो सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट रहता है हमारे गेम्स, मतलब मैं अगर एज अ पर्टिकुलर अपने ही बैडमिंटन की बात कहूँ, तो हमें बॉडी को लाइट रखना होता है, हमें पावर भी चाहिए, एनर्जी भी चाहिए, और उन सबको मैनेज करना है. मैनेज करने के लिए बैडमिंटन एजिलिटीज गेम है, तो एजिलिटीज में आपको मूवमेंट्स फास्ट चाहिए. तो इस केस में मेरे साथ एक प्रॉब्लम हो गई थी बीच में, यूरिक एसिड बढ़ने का, और मोस्टली इंडियंस को विटामिन डी की कमी होती है. तो सेम प्रोसेस में हमें स्पोर्ट पर्सन है तो हमें और कम था, तो मेरे लिए इंटेक करना था, लेकिन इंटेक करूंगा तो फिर यूरिक एसिड और प्रोग्रेस हो रहा था. तो मेरे लिए मेरी डाइटिशियन, मैं उनको थैंक यू कहूंगा कि उन्होंने बहुत कंट्रोल करवाया सब कुछ, और कहीं ना कहीं इस ब्रॉन्ज मेडल के पीछे उनका बड़ा हाथ है. तो मैं यही कहूंगा जो सबसे बड़ा इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट था इसमें, मैंने सीखा है कि सबसे पहले जितने भी लोग पूरे ऑल ओवर वर्ल्ड में, ऐसे इंडिया की बात नहीं करूंगा, कि आप सबसे पहले अपना चेकअप कराइए कि एग्जैक्टली आपके बॉडी में किस चीज की नीड है और किस चीज की नीड नहीं है. तो आपको मुझे लगता है चूज करना आसान हो जाएगा कि क्या आपको लेना पड़ेगा और क्या नहीं लेना है. तो दैट इज द मोस्ट थिंग कि आपको पहले पता होना चाहिए कि आपके बॉडी को नीड किस चीज की है. दूसरी चीज जैसे मैम ने कहा कि हाइजीनिक करना बहुत जरूरी है, और उससे भी इम्पोर्टेंट टाइमली आपको करना, क्योंकि सारा खाना जो है, आप जो भी आप खाते हैं, चाहे वो जूस हो, फ्रूट्स हो, फूड हो, कुछ भी आप खाते हो, तो कोई भी चीज खराब नहीं होती है, ज्यादा लेंगे तो ही खराब होती है. तो क्या लेना है, कितना लेना है और किस समय लेना है, ये बहुत बड़ा रोल है. तो एज अ स्पोर्ट पर्सन हमने इसी का फोकस रखा.
बहुत अच्छा कहा आपने. सो दिस इज अ गुड सेग्वे. मैं अभी प्रिया प्रकाश से पूछना चाहूंगी, हु इज द सीईओ ऑफ हेल्थ सेट गो. एंड प्रिया, यू आर वर्किंग इन स्कूल्स विद सेवरल चिल्ड्रन, सो व्हाट इज इट दैट यू आर फोकसिंग ऑन, एंड हैज दैट फोकस शिफ्टेड, यू नो, एज वाज प्रेजेंटेड जस्ट नाउ, दैट यू नो द पैंडेमिक चेंज्ड मेनी थिंग्स फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस. चिल्ड्रन हु वर गोइंग टू स्कूल आर नाउ नॉट गोइंग टू स्कूल. So what are some of the challenges you found young people face, you know, during this time? And you know, going forward, how are you thinking about good health and nutrition for children?
Thank you so much for the question, and just want to acknowledge that it's great to be on this panel. And again, congratulations to you, Manoj, for bringing home the medal. It's really amazing to hear you and have you give advice to all the young generation. They really need it. So coming to the question, you know, the pandemic has been very difficult for all of us, and it's been extremely stressful for the education ecosystem. As we know, overnight there was a lockdown and schools were shut. And of course, children being such a sensitive and vulnerable population, you know, they were the first to be completely put inside the houses. Parents were very scared that they should not get COVID, you know, if something happens to them or not, children should be completely safe. And, you know, in that whole gambit of safety, the whole world moving to online education at the you know, click of a button and a snap of the finger, I think it has been a very stressful time for teachers, for parents, for the entire education system to have this transition happening. And this stress has taken a toll on the children as well. I think, of course, children being inside, indoors, constantly, again, you know, even when the pandemic started to ease a bit, vaccination started to come out. Till now, we don't have a vaccination approved in India for the children to use. And so there's always that fear in the mind that, you know, this is a population that's still not protected. And even when the things started to ease out, adults used to go out, but children were still told, no, stay inside, stay at home, because parents were very scared. And that actually not only affected the physical health, but also the mental health of a lot of children. And I think when we talk about well-being, you know, both things come together. And due to the stress, and I think, you know, Dr. Jagmeet will also agree with this, that has a huge impact also on the physical health, right? Mental health and physical health go together. And what we are observing from so many schools that I've started speaking to, you know, children are coming back slowly and steadily. Every day we hear number one concern of the schools, apart from, of course, anxiety in children and cases of depression in children, is definitely obesity. Obesity has become on the rise. I'm only talking at this point about private schools. We'll touch upon the government schools as well. But obesity has been on the rise. A lot of children, because they were sedentary, there was lack of physical activity, there was lack of timings. Again, when they slept, what time they woke up. You know, we're all talking about timing here and the circadian rhythm that is to be followed and the timings of the meals. I think many of those things went haywire. And initially in the pandemic, you would see the global trends of a lot of less consumption of fresh food, and more consumption of packaged food being stored in the house for longer periods of time. So all of these things, you know, that have compounded over many months have now resulted in the kind of, I would say, the second pandemic that's happening right now internally is this, which is, you know, we are facing the obesity pandemic, we are facing a mental health pandemic. So this has been the major impact that we saw. Whereas in the government school side, you know, the midday meal programs were severely impacted. And because of that, I think, you know, the rise in the cases of malnutrition, many people who were this has a huge impact on the socioeconomic status as well, because many people who were in the middle class of India have now moved to poverty. So there's been a huge cut in, again, the quality of food being consumed by the country. So there are a lot of things that have impacted the health of children, unfortunately, and we will need a lot of time to catch up with this. So the more we do awareness sessions in schools right now, what we are doing is we are trying to create as much awareness about the role of nutrition as number one being an immunity aspect, because as we discussed, immunity and nutrition are very closely related. And considering there is no vaccine, you know, that someone can fall back on when it comes to children, I think parents need to take nutrition and a healthy lifestyle, including physical activity, as Manoj was saying, as one of the key ways of building immunity in children. And secondly, what we are going to do is that we're planning to do a lot of health checks as well in school, so that every child, you know, considering their BMI has increased and a few other issues, can be pointed out, because many people have not even seen a doctor in 2 years. Many children have not even visited a doctor in 2 years. So I think going forward, this is what is going to help us get back to normalcy. But I do think that schools play a huge role in making sure that this happens, because parents themselves are dealing with so much. And I would urge all educators listening in that have a health program in your school so that you can actually help these children mentally and physically.
Thank you. You know, you talked about a health program. Obviously, you know, we have to think about children in schools, but, you know, the work setting is another wonderful place where you can impact your employees, and, you know, those employees who have children, etc., can also be given better information. So this is a great segue. I want to move to, you know, Pavitra, who, you know, who looks at the people aspect of the business of PepsiCo. So what are some of the things or the changes that you have made in your company, or that you're aware companies are making to address the sole issue of, you know, understanding nutrition, understanding what needs to be done, not just in terms of food, but also in lifestyle, but and also extending that to your family? I think if you can talk a little bit about, you know, some of the unique things that have been done. And then I'll go back to Dr. Madan with, you know, a question, which is, you know, one of the other things is all these fads that have suddenly, not suddenly emerged, but they were always there. But let's first talk about nutrition in the workplace, as it were, and then move on to sort of the next section of this discussion.
Sure. No, thank you, Vinita, for the question, and really happy to be a part of this conversation, because I think the one big thing that this pandemic has really done and changed is, you know, brought about this entire conversation on health and given it a, you know, different dimensions, right? In the past, health was just about, all right, you know, largely fitness, you know, people were going to the gyms and working out, right? Not too much about nutrition, not too much about a simple thing like sleep, right? People are talking about sleep today as one of the most important things. So I think you know, from a workplace perspective, a lot changed, right? And as Priya was saying, overnight things changed. You know, people were dealing with a number of different kinds of anxiety, right? You know, parents were struggling because suddenly it was about, you know, do I have a job? You know, and therefore that the stress and the anxiety, right? You know, of whether I have a job in the first place. Second was about really safety, you know, that of, you know, my, me and my family and COVID and children, right? Safety. The third was just handling the personal pieces, juggling work and juggling school of a child who's now working and who's now studying remotely, you know, gadgets at home. So a whole, you know, host of anxiety and stresses that people were facing, right? And I think one of the biggest things that I learned during this phase was, you know, and what we implemented was really listening first, really understanding what are those issues before you even tackle those issues, what are the pain points? And finally, you know, it, you know, when we looked at the issues and when we started listening to people, the issues were very different for different cohorts, right? Women were going through a very different set of issues because they were trying to figure out, they needed that 9 to 10 o'clock, a simple insight that came to us. We used to have meetings starting at 9 o'clock, for example, right? 9, 9:30. That was the exact time that the child had to actually start his laptop, you know, and get into class. Now, imagine the plight of the parent, right? Should I attend the meeting or should I actually get my child settled? Okay, a simple insight like that, right? And these are real issues. A lot of people didn't have house help, you know, and therefore they were juggling and breakfast therefore coming into play, right? A lot of them were skipping breakfast because guess what? You didn't have the time. You were juggling so many things and skipping breakfast. And I think that one simple insight through the listening sessions helped us to make that one big change. We said, all right, no meetings before 10 o'clock. Okay, let's give enough break times for people to decide what they want to do. So during lunch, you know, 12:30 to 2:30, it was a blackout zone. You know, do what you want to do. If you have to go and attend and, you know, make a meal, please go ahead and do that. If you want to take some time to just go through your meals, you have that flexibility, right? And no meetings after 7. Now that actually dramatically made a difference because like Manoji was saying, right? You have to be happy. Mentally, you have to be, you know, happy. We saw a lot of people were getting irritated and flustered because of the inability to manage. So I think that was one big piece that we did and that really helped. The second was, you know, involving family, you know, to your question, right? And when COVID happened, suddenly everybody was cocooned, right? You were confined to your single room. And suddenly all the fitness activity that you were used to doing outside stopped. So a quick step that we did was, and I think a lot of organizations you would have heard doing that, was online classes, right? And that the fact that we were online actually in a way was, it has been a boon to us as well, because now we've been able to engage families, you know, parents, in-laws, children, right? And we started the 7 o'clock in the morning and 7 o'clock in the evening, we started these online classes, yoga for kids, right? Physical activity for kids. And we saw a huge uptake, right? So that started a trend of, you know, making sure that, hey, I can start doing physical activity even at home, you know? Third thing that we did was, you know, the entire consciousness and awareness of nutrition, you know, of sleep. So there was physical activity, there was sleep, and there was nutrition, right? And taking it forward to all employees, to the ecosystem as well, you know, and family members, and talking about what it really means when we talk about nutrition. So a lot of things, Vinita, I think has really helped, you know, to bring in awareness in terms of, you know, what it really means when you talk about fitness, and when you talk about health and wellness, it's just not physical. One part of it is physical, but as a part of physical, there is, you know, food, there's nutrition, there's sleep, but there's equally another very big piece, which is mental, you know, and I think that is where we kind of did a number of sessions to remove the taboo, because there was a lot of taboo associated with mental wellness, right? And we did a series of sessions right from the top, the leadership teams talking about mental health, right? And why it's important to really address that issue. And I think that really helped. And, you know, we've got, everybody has today the EAP lines, right? But guess what? If you look at the data, you really don't see too many people using the EAP lines, right? The moment we started having and addressing the mental health issue, and we started having leaders talking about their issues, how they've also faced some of these issues, right? We saw the EAP line, and we saw the, you know, the kind of, you know, conversation that started picking up, and the conversions, you know, take to the next level. So which means that really shows that there is, you know, people want to talk about it, but they are not able to talk about it because of the so-called taboo. And therefore, that's the role that corporates can play, actively play, you know, in terms of just removing the taboo, talking about it, because, you know, it's like it's part of your life. I mean, if you're going through it, how can we help you? How can we address that issue? And how can we collectively, you know, sail through this? Mm-hmm. So I think mental health has been a big, big piece that we've really been focusing on. And
that's,
I think...
that's a great insight, because, you know, typically, you know, when we talk about health, we don't normally include, you know, mental health as part of health. And, you know, Manoj also referred to it in a different way, saying that, you know, in order to concentrate on what you're doing, you know, food plays a big role. So, Dr. Madan, I want to come back to you with, you know, two issues. One is, you know, what we eat. A layperson's understanding is also enables you, you know, sometimes you eat very heavy food and you feel lethargic. There are foods that make you feel good, etc. So what is the relationship, just simply between, you know, foods we consume and how we feel? And the second thing is that, you know, which was also shared in the work or in the study that was done, which is that, you know, I'm spending too much time in front of a screen. I'm not able to be as physically active. You know, then I go on these fads of diet. I do a keto diet. I do intermittent fasting. I do all kinds of things. But then, you know, I go and I do binge eating and nothing works. So I feel even more, you know, challenged, saying that I've tried all this, but I'm still not losing weight. So, you know, we all know somebody who's been through this story. So tell us a little bit about why these fads, you know, how to deal with these fads. And, you know, secondly, the role of food, you know, in both physical well-being as well as mental well-being.
Okay. So I think very, very pertinent questions, Vinita. See, the thing is that, let me again start from millennials. See, when you look at millennials, one statement I always make for them is that looks can be deceptive. So very often, you know, looking at your BMI, looking at your just weight, you may think you really don't need to pay attention to your diet. That is one. Okay, but we have young adults who are low BMI. They are not carrying excess weight, but they are carrying excess body fat, And we have done, we have gathered data from 1,300 millennials in Mumbai city. And you will be shocked to know that 30% of them had hyperinsulinemia. That means they had elevated insulin levels, but they are completely unaware of what's happening within their body, right? So this brings me to the point that somewhere in the diary of a millennial, food is not a priority, but pandemic, when it struck, I think somewhere food became a priority because we understood that, you know, it is the nutrition which has to be set right that only will help us get the immunity, get the resistance to fight the pandemic. So nutrition literacy has become a mandate today. And to my mind, it is a fundamental right of every citizen of this country to be nutritionally literate. And nutrition literacy is not rocket science. It is something as simple, you know, if you just empower yourself to understand what are your everyday foods and what are your sometime foods. I think it is only this much of dissemination of knowledge, if it reaches people and they don't make their sometime foods everyday food, you know, they can prevent the disaster. And this applies to the millennials. So that is where I emphasize on the word quality nutrition. And I think something very simple to make anybody nutrition literate is that if you want quality eating, please look at your plate every time you sit down to eat. And when you look at your plate, ask three questions to yourself. The first question, where is protein on my plate, right? It's a very important, you know, component of your plate. So you have to have some food which is rich in protein, whether you have an egg, whether you have curd, whether you have milk, whether you have a bowl of pulse, whether you have paneer, whether you have, you know. So what I'm trying to say is you need to know which are the food which give you protein, not only protein, but good quantity and quality of protein. So first question is, where is my protein? My protein should be there in my breakfast, in my lunch, in my snack, and in my dinner. I cannot skip my protein in any of the meals. And I can't have all my proteins in one meal. That is also not acceptable to the body because the body will not be in a position to utilize it up to the optimum. The second question I ask is, where is that fiber in my diet? Or where is the fiber in my plate? I think let's look at our plate. So the fiber is coming from your vegetables and fruits. So half your plate should be filled with vegetables. So whether you take it as salad, whether you take it as sorted vegetables, whether you take it as cooked vegetable, and let me say potato is not a vegetable, okay? If you had two bowls of potato bhaji and you said, I had my half plate filled with vegetables, I'm sorry, you added two more chapatis to your plate, okay? So when we say vegetables, we are looking at what Ms. Inoshi said, something which is local, seasonal, green, colored, anything which is available in your region, right? And the third question is that what is the quantity of carbohydrate which is there in my plate? That means my cereal, not only just carbohydrate, my cereal. And this cereal should not be your rumali roti, your white bread, you know, your bun, your maida roll. It should be a wholesome whole grain cereal, which gives you fiber and micronutrients. But two important things. One is that the cereal has to be wholesome. And second, it has to be rationed. Okay, so one important message which needs to go to the millennials and the Indian population is carbohydrate or cereals are not a free food. They need to be taken in ration quantity in your plate. You need to prioritize your protein, your dietary fiber, and give only that much importance to your cereal. So that's point number one. Now, coming to your second question, that, you know, when you study the millennials, you know, they're different people. They, for them, meals is really not on their diary. So they are definitely on snacking, yeah? So we've done studies wherein we found that 60% of the total intake of millennials comes from snacks. And a lot of them are dependent on foods which are ordered, you know, outside. A lot of outside food is, you know, something which becomes a part of their day. And they're also technologically savvy. So they keep looking at different sites and they want to know the different diets. And then they look at the testimonials and they have their role models. So if so-and-so is following this diet, so let me also follow this diet. So I think this is a half story which they get on the media. You know, when you look at celebrities who follow certain diets or certain regime, you do not know their total life. I mean, what else do they do along with what they're doing, you know, to their diet? And let me tell you, most of them are guided by professional nutritionists who would be, you know, telling them that if you're doing this, maybe your diet will get deficient in this. So you need to take something, you know, to take care of that. Now, coming to the fad diets, you know, my whole approach to this fad diet, and I think two diets have been very, very prevalent in the whole pandemic, is one has been the intermittent fasting, and the second has been the keto diet, right? Now, to my mind, intermittent fasting is not bad, okay? Intermittent fasting is basically talking about the way you eat, okay? Now, there are windows in intermittent fasting. So they say 18 hours of, you know, fasting and 6 hours of eating, 20 hours of fasting and 4 hours of eating, or 16 hours of fasting and 8 hours of eating. So somewhere, I think from here, what we need to pick up is that if we decide that we will eat within 8 to 10 hours of window from the time we get up, and we do not miss our important meal like breakfast, and we close our shop early, that means we have an early dinner, I think there is nothing wrong in intermittent fasting, okay? Because we know for sure that if you give a long gap between your last meal, which is an early meal, and you have your breakfast, you benefit in terms of all the anti-inflammatory hormones which go against you. And you also decrease ghrelin, which is something which increases your appetite. Because you know, the moment you have a late night, you tend to eat more, you know, you are doing all those kind of things. So intermittent fasting, again, it's a fad diet. If you start following it literally, you go by the, you know, the reviews of your celebrities or role models, you may go wrong. So you, some things like this should be done under professional advice. Now coming to keto diet, that's just the last statement.
Yeah.
So keto diets are the diets which are actually restricting carbohydrate drastically, okay? And they are definitely promoting fats and they're promoting proteins. So overdoing on protein and overdoing on fats without paying attention to the quality of fat and giving very less importance to carbohydrate, you are actually disturbing the balance, okay? Because it's the carbohydrate which will spare the protein for the purpose of anabolism. So, and let's also understand that as Indians, we are carbohydrate people. Okay, how long would you sustain on a keto diet? First of all, you should never do it on your own. You
Got
should
it.
Be always guided. Mm-hmm. And what is needed is a modified version of keto diet for Indians, like which I explained in the Indian plate, that you need restricted carbohydrate, not...
I think that's a... Yeah, thank you. I think that's a very, very good perspective. So, Manoj, let me, ask you the most obvious question. You know, as a sports person who's expending, you know, more energy than the average person, what has been the guidance that, you know, you have received or that you would like to share with young people or even older people who are in as part of this discussion, who lead a fairly active life? Because, you know, is it about higher proteins? You know, sports people, we keep hearing of, you know, increased consumption of whey powder and things like that. So, aapki diet mein, kya, you know, what was special, if anything, or jo aap continually karte hain, ye nahi ki jab मैच हुआ उस दिन किया उसके बाद भूल गए. अब म्यूट पे हैं मनोज.
थैंक यू मैम. एक्चुअली मदान मैम ने एक चीज बहुत पॉइंट में एक चीज बहुत अच्छा कहा उन्होंने कि इम्पोर्टेंट यही है कि आपको पता होना चाहिए कि आपको कब खाना है, इवन मॉर्निंग का ब्रेकफास्ट तो बिल्कुल एक्सीड नहीं करना। दूसरा चीज कि प्रोटीन और कार्बोहाइड्रेट मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट हमारे बॉडी के लिए इंपॉर्टेंट होता है। मैं स्पोर्ट पर्सन हूँ, धीरे धीरे मैं भी जान रहा हूँ डाइटिशियन से मिलके और न्यूट्रिशन से मिलके कि कैसे क्या करते हैं, लेकिन मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट मैं सबके लिए यही कहूंगा, जितने भी लोग आज सुन रहे हैं या जितने भी मिलेनियर्स से जो स्किप करते हैं ब्रेकफास्ट खास करके, तो मैं अपने गेम के बारे में सिर्फ इतना ही कहूंगा कि अपने गेम के थ्रू कि फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल कि हम टाइमली सब कुछ लेते हैं, सेकेंड थिंग कि हमारे प्लेट्स में हम लोग यही कोशिश करते हैं कि भाई प्रोटीन और कार्बोहाइड्रेट दोनों चीज रहे। दूसरा जो इंपॉर्टेंट रहता है जो हमारा जो सेकंड फेज होता है टूर्नामेंट्स टाइम का, लिटिल जैसे हम टूर्नामेंट पास आता है और टूर्नामेंट हमारा चलता है, तो उस टाइम पे हम मोस्टली टाइम बॉडी लाइट रखने के लिए हम सब कुछ लेते हैं, लेकिन क्वांटिटी जो वेस्ट होता है वो लिटिल लिटिल करके हमने पूरा इंटेक्ट करते हैं। ऐसा नहीं है कि हम वन टाइम में पूरा ले लिया और फिर स्किप कर लिया, क्योंकि क्या होता है कि हमने मॉर्निंग में ले लिया और आफ्टरनून नहीं लिया या फिर नाइट नहीं लिया, तो सेकेंड डे हमारी बॉडी बिल्कुल कंजम्प्ट हो जाएगा, एकदम खत्म होना है वहां पे और हमारी बॉडी बिल्कुल वर्कआउट में नहीं आएगा। तो बेस्ट पार्ट यही रहता है कि हम लोग जब प्रैक्टिस शेड्यूल में रहते हैं तो प्रॉपर चैन सिस्टम से करते हैं, प्रॉपर टाइमिंग से, यही कि आपके पास कार्बोहाइड्रेट ताकि मसल्स ग्रोथ जो आपकी है, मसल्स जो आपकी फटीक होती है वो जल्दी इंप्रूव हो जाए, जल्दी ठीक हो जाए वो, और दूसरा प्रोटीन से आपकी जो एनर्जी लेवल है वो आपकी बनी रहे। और जैसे जैसे टूर्नामेंट टाइम पे होता है तो हमारा यही सारी चीजें क्वांटिटी कम होने के बाद मैक्सिमम टाइमिंग बढ़ जाती है, लाइक कि अगर दो अगर हम चार रोटी खा रहे हैं तो उसको हम दो रोटी कर देते हैं एक टाइम पे, फिर दो घंटे बाद हम करते हैं एज अ स्पोर्ट पर्सन, ये हमारी डाइटिशियन। तो मुझे सभी से ही रिक्वेस्ट है कि प्लीज आप अपना जो फॉलो अप लेते हैं, मैम ने कहा कि सेलिब्रिटीज को देखते हैं कई लोग हमें भी फॉलो करते हैं, तो ऐसा नहीं है कि हम ले रहे हैं तो आप भी यही लेंगे, अब आप प्लीज ये मत करिएगा, क्योंकि हमारा शेड्यूल अलग है, हो सकता है हम आपसे ज्यादा वर्कआउट करते हैं या हो सकता है हम आपसे कम वर्कआउट करते हैं, तो आप अपने वर्कआउट के हिसाब से अपना शेड्यूल देखिए, अपने टाइमिंग देखिए और उसके बाद चूज करिए। और हाँ प्लीज ये स्किप मत करिए कुछ भी, अगर आप फैट आपके पास उसको बर्न कर लेंगे और ज्यादा वर्कआउट करके फैट गायब कर देंगे तो सीरियसली ये नहीं हो सकता, पॉसिबल नहीं है, क्योंकि आपको खाना ही पड़ेगा, नहीं तो आपकी एनर्जी लेवल इतना लो हो जाएगा कि आप सेकंड सेशन नहीं कर पाएंगे, आपके वर्कआउट नहीं कर पाएंगे।
थैंक यू। हाँ, जब आप कह रहे थे मैं वही सोच रही थी कि हम आपकी डाइट और अपनी एक्सरसाइज का कॉम्बिनेशन तो सबसे सब ऑप्टिमल कॉम्बिनेशन होगा। So, Inoshi, as part of, you know, the work that FSSAI is doing, not just in terms of Eat Right, you know, you're also putting out several messages on media. And, you know, you're giving, you know, if it is a bengan, here are some of the recipes for that. Can you tell us a little bit about what has been the response to that? And, you know, what are people actually seeking? How much of that is, you believe, going through in terms of, you know, easy to do, you know, recipes and so on with things, as Dr. Madan was saying, we consume every day, you know, the lokis and the bengans and the bindis and so on.
So, yeah, so that was actually, you know, an initiative we just, you know, thought about something in office, and we just thought, like, let's for 1 year, every month, take up a vegetable, which is, you know, in season, and give it a little twist in terms of the recipes that we have. So everybody usually has the, you know, standard Indian masalas and the oil or the ghee. What if we gave it a little bit of a twist, sometimes steamed it or baked it or, you know, stir fried it or added some different types of ingredients in it. Maybe, you know, it was something that became more interesting for you know, young people to have, or even, you know, older people to have. Similarly, that was also the time that we thought, you know, let's just through our social media handles also encourage people to reduce salt, sugar and fat. So there was this series of 7 days, 21 days to a fitter you. So 7 days right. Reduce your salt, 7 days reduce your sugar, 7 days reduce your fat. Now, the response was, in fact, unbelievable. So whenever we would come to a vegetable, which was particularly unpopular among people, they actually were so surprised. Oh, wow, we had no idea that you could make it like this, you know. Mm. So a lot of people actually, some of our most popular recipes were, in fact, based on pumpkin. And then when we did the God family, so we actually got a lot of positive results. This year, we've taken up millets. So September onwards, we've come out with an entire series of millets. So we take one millet every month. For instance, in the north, a lot of people don't know some of the millets which are, say, available in the south. Or in the south, they would not know about the millets which are available in the north. So these actually provide you with information about the diversity which is there in the country and what all millets can you have. Having said this, we would also, I feel that we also need to, you know, tell people the right time to have millets. It should not be that in the north, you're having a millet in the peak of summers when you really can't digest it. So that is something, again, we've seen a lot of people indiscriminately trying to become super healthy, incorporating, you know, all healthy things throughout the day and still not being healthy. And that's probably because, you know, we don't realize that every cuisine comes with that particular region's flavor, the climate. So that is something that needs to be recognized. Mm. So I'm so glad you brought that issue up about vegetables.
Yeah, I think that's a very important point, which is, you know, we have to recognize the context. You know, everything can't be eaten at every time. In fact, I think our grandmothers simplified it a lot when they said, ki, you know, mausam ki phal aur sabji khani chahiye. Now, you know, if you follow that, the only problem is that these days, I remember growing up in Delhi, watermelon always only used to be available in summer, but now watermelon is available right through the year. So coming to, Priya and the work that, again, you're doing with schools, and I'm not sure whether you interact with parents and so on. What are some of the initiatives that you've got which actually, you know, give a more, nuanced layer to the whole concept of nutrition, what to eat, when to eat? What is the other help or facilities that you're providing to these people?
Yes, thank you for that question. So if we recall, I think what Manoj was also saying earlier, that, you know, in order to improve our health or change our health, I think first we need to know where we stand on our health. And I think a lot of people don't know that because they haven't ever, got an analysis done of their body. I think Dr. Jagmeet was also saying about that, you know, it's about body composition and a couple of other things. So before we go about figuring out the right diet or the right exercise regime, I think it's really important to hone into our bodies through the help of medical professionals or a nutritionist. And I think that is what we do in school settings. So we have a team of doctors, and these doctors visit the school because a lot of times parents are unable to take their children to different doctors. And, you know, children, as they're growing, they have different issues that can crop up at any time. So not only the BMI issue, but also an eye issue, dental health, their entire physical examination. In India, I think we're a culture of curative versus preventive, you know, and I think the whole term of healthcare is also very misinterpreted because it's not healthcare, it's actually more sick care that's followed in India. So when we talk about healthcare, you know, we need to prevent, and for that, we need to go to the doctor before something is wrong, you know, at least get an analysis done of what is happening, what are your levels of vitamins, and, you know, different things need to be analyzed. So at a screening level, we actually sent a team of doctors to schools. We have a different specialty. So a pediatrician, an ophthalmologist, a nutritionist, you know, different profiles. They go to the school to check different aspects. And once these are analyzed and screened for a child, it's translated into an online medical record. And I think that's one other thing that's very important, that we all have our medical records in place, because I don't have my medical records when I was a child, and I don't know where are all our medical records. Now only India is moving towards that health ID, digital health ID, but it will still take a long time to adopt that. But meanwhile, at least we are making sure that all the vaccinations, all the doctor visits in the school are tracked online. So basically parents can see very easily, okay, my child needs a new pair of spectacles, or my child needs to go to the nutritionist, or my child needs to visit the physician for a thorough examination. Because, you know, we might think that a lot of issues are happening to adults, but from a medical analysis level, I can tell you, children are also going through a lot of issues. Specifically in teenage years, there's a lot of hormonal issues. PCOD is such a common thing now. Even pre-diabetes, in a lot of children, they have very high blood sugar levels as well. So I think a lot of these things need to be addressed. So once we know what is the health status of a child and the parents have an online medical record, based on that, the parents can take further action. So I think it's important to empower with the data so that you can actually take action based on the data. And you can see some trends, right? What was my child's BMI? Let's say I'm taking an example of BMI last year or last few months. At home, I think we all have that wall in which the children's height is marked and everything. But from a school perspective, if it's done professionally, that's also great. And you know, you can see the trends, a graph and everything. So I think that is one of our initiatives that we're doing. And apart from that, online education is always on because of the pandemic. We're doing a lot of sessions in schools, and we are trying to create awareness that way.
Great. Thank you. I think I'll direct my last question to Pavitra. And then after that, I will drop off the call. And Meetu or Richa, if you could take over with audience questions, and then we'll get into questions from the audience for the panelists. So Pavitra, just building on from what Priya just said, you know, this whole thing and what Inoshi was saying earlier, you know, given that PepsiCo is such a food company, you've got the best food technologists, the best flavor people, etc. You know, is there any incremental work that is happening which actually is creating an interest in these, you know, things like kaddu and gourd and millets, etc., so that it becomes more attractive for people to incorporate them into their everyday meals. You know, otherwise it's like, you know, who's going to have a pumpkin? But I think, as Inoshi said, some of the feedback they've got has been very encouraging. So what is some of the work that a company like PepsiCo, which is so steeped in food and food technology, doing to make ordinary, you know, vegetables and food taste really great?
Yeah. No, very interesting question. And, you know, like she spoke about pumpkin, you know, for us, I think, you know, Quaker was the other piece, you know, as part of our portfolio, right? Just educating people about the benefits of whole grain like Quaker, you know, and how do you kind of add that to and make it interesting and make it a part of your diet, right? So we started a couple of things. First of all, involving family and their, you know, employees and the family members, right? Give us a recipe, you know, use Quaker, okay, in a very interesting fashion, and bring in seasonal vegetables, you know, and have diet recipes that you can actually share. So we started actually integrating, you know, products from our portfolio, and we've started giving it a different twist by engaging with families, you know, and running these competitions, right? That, you know, even explaining to people that Quaker and the whole grain concept, right? And as Dr. Madan spoke about, you know, what is there in your plate, right? It's just not carbohydrates, but, you know, the quality of that grain that you have. Is it whole grain that you're having? So we've started that a different approach of engaging families, getting recipes. We've got a hobby club, for example, you know, which is actually dedicated to food, you know. So this hobby club, again, made out of employees, talk about different recipes, share these recipes. So we've got cookbooks, you know, coming from the employees' households, you know, and when we had the physical office, of course, we had sessions happening in the office, you know, where we were trying to promote, again, the intake of whole grains, along with, you know, seasonal vegetables and fruits. So that's what we've been doing, Vinita, to kind of encourage people. And in this process, also engage with children, you know, and getting them into this, you know, and creating that awareness among the children as well.
Thank you very much. And one said, Meetu, is there something that you're launching?
Yeah, we were just about to do the formal launch of the app. So as we continue the session, one is to thank you so much for you know, facilitating this conversation and drawing out these insights. I think the launch of the app that we're going to do, and I'm going to request my colleague Richa to go ahead and do that. And this is, again, a very interesting app which allows you to really check your biological age and then, you know, sign up for consulting with an expert dietitian. And the idea is that, you know, more of us take ownership of our own health and get really engaged, as this is, you know, participatory. It's not someone telling you what to do. It's making sure that we take the actions that we need to. So over to you, Richa.
Thank you, Meetu. Thank you, Ms. Bali, for facilitating this session and for this very informative and engaging session throughout hearing about a lot of initiatives and the mindset which we are planned and we can follow to work further on. So it's the moment now for all of us, which we are waiting for the launch of the app. So can we have the video, please? So this is the app Aspire to Be, and to begin to drive this health and fitness agenda forward. So this is the app developed by PepsiCo and Quaker. And I request Ankita to just give a brief snapshot about the app to all of us. And yeah, we really want all of us to be on this journey with us. And the moment she explains, we'll open up the registration, the sign up link for registration. And we request each one of you to join us and just sign up for the app to begin this exciting journey. Over to you, Ankita.
Sure, thanks. So thanks for an engaging conversation. And I think all of us have spoken and the panelists here have really made that aspect very clear that it's not one size fits all. And Manoj also mentioned that probably he as an athlete would be having something different, and you and I could be having something different. So hence an app, we could be having the same age, you and I could be of the same age, but how our internal, how our body and mind has really aged, that could be very different. So through this app, you will get to know your biological age. That is, if your actual age is, for example, 30 years, but internally how you have aged, whether you are 40 or whether you are 20. So it will give you some direction, and then it will help you understand what is the path you can take. What are the simple things which you can do to improve your biological age? And these simple changes are nothing but our everyday lifestyle changes. We will support through Quaker. We will be providing this app, and it is a pilot phase. So it is still under development. So in another 2-3 weeks, you will have this link of the app. It is first come, first serve basis. So we would open it for some part of the population and then see how the response is. And in addition to that, we will also be giving you consultation with an expert dietitian, so that you can clarify all your diet and your wellness issues. So looking forward and hoping that you all start your journey to be the real fit.
Thank you so much, Ankita, for this brief snapshot about the app, and the link is already there. So I request each one of you to please sign up for the app and let's begin this journey together and just track our health in a very right way. So please do that. So coming to the question and answers now from the audience we have. So they have heard a lot about from the panelists and the initiatives, what is going on and what can be done. So there are a few questions posted from the audience as well. So to begin with, the first question is for Dr. Jagmeet Madan. I have shared the question with you, ma'am. So it is on the daily requirements and the gap and consumption of fiber in Indian diets. So it says traditional Indian diets are believed to be much richer in fiber as compared to traditional Western diets by general population. So how significant has the transition in fiber consumption in India over the past 10, 15 years? Okay. So ma'am, your views on that?
I think that's an excellent question, and I could read it's from none other than Dr. Sarat Gopalan, whom I really respect and I have immense regard for. So I think we all know that, you know, today we talk about gut health, right? And if you really want a good gut health, the definition of gut health is how many favorable or beneficial microflora you have in your gut versus the pathogenic ones. And to favor the, formation of healthy microflora, the base of that or substrate is fiber, dietary fiber. And, so that's something which we never bothered as Indians, because, if you say 2 decades back, we were very close to our traditional diets. And, we never had these kind of options. Maybe the global cuisine options which are available today to today's millennials. and today's population. So somewhere we started drifting from what was so good for us and so good for our gut health, and that, you know, we realized that you know, gradually we have decreased the dietary fiber from our diet. So you're right, Dr. Sarath, there has been a drastic change from what we used to eat, say, two decades back. But I would say that the last decade has seen the revival of sensitization, or bringing back the millennials, the young adults of this country to the fact that, you know, you have to make a conscious effort to see that you get a good amount of fiber in your diet. So whether you talk of you know, pulses and legumes, which are actually a heritage of Indian diets, you know, so you have so much variety available, and we've done some work you know, on the resistant starch content of legumes and pulses. It is amazingly high, and it works like a prebiotic or a substrate which will favor good microflora. Similarly, now we are talking about millets. We are wanting to revive millets. And I'm so glad, Miss, you know, she said that they're going to pick one millet every month. And it is so very right that, you know, so many of us don't even know what are the millets, you know, which are grown in our own regions. So they will be more accessible, they will be more economical, and yet they are filled with dietary fiber. They are filled with you know, additional micronutrients and phytochemicals. So yes, there is a concerted effort in the last one decade, and I would say in the last 5 years, the government of India has taken you know, nutrition as a national mandate. And I congratulate FSSAI for doing a brilliant job in knowledge dissemination, you know, based on evidence-based data, scientific data, and converting it into an applied form, reaching out to people through social media handles. And so I think this has been a transition, yes, but today people are more sensitized. I think pandemic was a huge learning experience where everyone put their antennas up to know more about what is eating right. And so I think we are definitely moving the right way now.
Thank you so much. Or I think Dr. Gopalan is convinced with the detailed answer. And I think in line with the notion, same concept, the next question is for Ms. Inoshi Sharma. Like, FSSAI is doing a lot to spread awareness on food adulteration and simple recipes for nutritious food. So is there any some ways we can access all these tools in our effort to create a Eat Right campus? And then maybe you can elaborate on like how a public-private partnership in government with alliance can mainstream this health and fitness agenda. Over to you, ma'am.
So all the information regarding the various Eat Right initiatives is available on the Eat Right India website. It's simply www.eatrightindia.gov.in. And there we've got under resources, all the videos, our books, our pamphlets, all our documents available. And under programs, we have listed down all the programs, the Eat Right School, Eat Right Campus, Clean Street Food Hub, Hogue, all our programs. So for the Eat Right Campus, if you go on the website and click on Eat Right Campus, or you can separately also click on Eat Right Campus or gov.in for FSSAI, then you also get information regarding the Eat Right Campus. Any campus which has a reasonable number of people, even if it has a small tea shop or even a kiosk, and it just wants to improve on the health of its employees or create awareness among them, they can register for it. It's a very simple program in which you just have to do, a pre-audit to see what is the awareness level among people, what is the hygiene level among people. And then you can do a post-audit after training of the people as to how much have they assimilated the information. So with regards to public-private partnership, we do encourage corporate houses and the FBOs to invest part of their CSR in some of our efforts, because ultimately it is benefiting the consumers and then the society at large. So we have, in fact, a program, Corporates for Social Responsibility within FSSAI, in which we have these regular sessions with FPOs. And we do have a lot of FPOs coming up and asking us places to invest in CSR. So that is going on.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for the response. So the next question is for Priya. Like we spoke about the initiatives from the school, like it's the need of the hour because of the pandemic, a lot of overweight, obesity, and pre-diabetic, the kids are going, and insulin dependency is there, so which is a raising concern among parents. So we would really like to know that how industry can collaborate to build, you know, strong monitoring and delivery system, ensuring that we start right from the school. That is the path. Like, what are the new innovations? Because a lot of policy and program which we see, they more talk about that we start from the 1,000-day window or the adolescent approach. So there is a need where we need to, you know, rewind or shift our approach to this. So your views on that?
Yes, I think this is a very great question because you know, for a long time, because of these Millennium Development Goals that we had before the SDGs came in, the Sustainable Development Goals, there was a huge focus on mother and child nutrition. And of course, that is still a huge problem and it carries on being a problem. But because of the Sustainable Development Goals, because now the world is facing issues like non-communicable diseases, which are cancer, diabetes, heart disease, a lot of people are realizing that these are hugely influenced by lifestyle. And when you talk about lifestyle, a lot of the habits that we build start from a very, very young age. In fact, like I said, many of these diseases, a lot of the markers of these diseases, like obesity, for example, one huge, huge precursor to some of these diseases, starts from a very young age. You know, so now it is more critical that after 1,000 days, all the interventions stop, you know, as if we have cured the problems that are out there. But I feel like it needs to start, if not start then, but continue on until the child is an adult. Because if we fix a lot of the behaviors and a lot of the internalized education about health and wellness at a young age, we will be saving our country billions of dollars in healthcare. Right now, there are so many sick people who are not getting access to medication, who are not getting access to hospitals. You know, why get to that stage when you can actually prevent a lot of the diseases which are related to lifestyle from happening? And hence we need to do that. So I think policy plays a huge role. At this point, it's not compulsory for schools to have this as a part of their working. I think that is something that needs to happen. If you look at other countries, health and wellness is a huge part of it, a huge, huge part of it, honestly. And right now we are discounting the role that it's playing, specifically mental health and physical health. We are really discounting the role that it's playing in education. A healthy person can do everything better in their life. If all of us are healthy, for example, we can focus on our work. We can be better people who do a better job at our work. Similarly with kids, how can you expect a child to pay attention in class when he has 20 things that are bothering him, for example, you know, mentally and physically? So I think more importance needs to be given from the policy side. If industries, for example, private industries are willing to cooperate and actually make school health programs one of the priorities, the budgets need to be assigned to this. So there's a host of things that need to happen before this goes further. For example, if there are ICSE schools and CBSE schools, they actually, before a school gets accredited, they ask for a huge list of things to be there in the school. But can we also make healthcare a key click point for any school to be empaneled, you know? So these are some of the things that can happen. Of course, a lot of work needs to happen, but I really hope that if anybody here has any ideas, please feel free to reach out, and happy to collaborate in any way.
No, I think this is indeed great and must be done. And the organization, like we have FSSAI, we have Dr. Jatmeet Madan. So I think all of us, when come together and being from the industry standpoint, and we are very happy and proud to share that during the Poshan Maah initiative, we did certain sessions with school, imparting nutrition education to them, like what is the need, how COVID has impacted us, and what changes to be done. And they really appreciated the teachers, principal, the students were very happy, the parents were, because they are not getting the right guidance. Right information is very, very important. And yeah, not just Googling out and
need
just,
for it. Like yeah. It's an unmet need.
Exactly, exactly. And I think this must be done. And we really look forward to conduct such sessions to save our generation for building a resilient and healthier India. So thank you so much, Priya. So next question is for Manoj ji. Like हमने बात कर ली है schools की, बच्चों की, but अगर अब हम youth पे आते हैं तो आजकल जो हम बहुत ज्यादा देख रहे हैं कि protein shakes, whey protein, ये consumption बहुत ज्यादा है among the youth, और अपनी diet को compromise करके they are going more towards the supplements, कि diet नहीं खा रहे हैं, ये pills ले रहे हैं या ऐसे shakes ले रहे हैं, shortcut है कि fitness चाहिए, zero size image चाहिए, gymming है, competition है. So what is your take on that? I think आपसे आएगा तो कुछ मैसेज हमारे यूथ तक जाएगा, so I really want कि आप इस पे कुछ बात करें.
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, थैंक यू रिचा जी. एक्चुअली मैं आपको इसमें सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट पार्ट एज अ स्पोर्ट पर्सन मैं कहूंगा कि सबसे पहले जो पार्ट है कि हमारी जो बॉडी है वो कहीं ना कहीं ऐसा बना हुआ है कि हमें सब कुछ चाहिए, लेकिन आज के टाइम में हम देखते हैं कि चीजें इतने चेंज हो गए कि हमें शॉर्टकट में चीजें चाहिए. तो शॉर्टकट के लिए हम लोग क्या करते हैं कि पैकेट फूड्स और बाकी चीजें ज्यादा से ज्यादा कंज्यूम करते हैं कि ताकि हमें जल्दी जल्दी रिजल्ट मिले या जल्दी जल्दी हमें बनाना पड़े, तो सारी चीजें प्रॉब्लम्स हो जाती है. तो मैं सिर्फ इन सभी को यही कहूंगा कि आप जितना रियलिटी में चीजें लेंगे उतनी आपके लिए ज्यादा अच्छी है. जैसे लाइक अगर टीथ की बात करें, हमारे जो दाँते हैं वो ज्यादा मजबूत तब होंगे जब आप सेब को काट के नहीं अपने दाँतों से काट के खाएंगे. आप चाकू से काट के खाएंगे तो उसमें उतना जूस बना के उतना मजा नहीं आएगा. आप उससे दांत अगर दांतों से खाएंगे तो ज्यादा एंजॉय करेंगे. दूसरी चीज जो सबसे ज्यादा इम्पोर्टेंट है वो इसमें ये है कि फूड पैकेज में भी कंटेंट लिखे होते हैं कि आपको इसमें क्या क्या कंटेंट है, कितना फैट है, कितना शुगर है. तो कई बार हम उसको पढ़ते भी नहीं है, तो वो बुरी चीज नहीं है, लेकिन आपकी बॉडी के लिए क्या वो चीज सही है या नहीं है आप उसको जानिए तो सही. तो कई बार हमें उन चीजों के बारे में नॉलेज रखना पड़ेगा. दूसरी चीज जितने भी खास करके जिम वाले हैं, जितने भी हम मेरे जिम लवर्स हैं, जितने भी लोग जो जिम करते हैं, इवन हम भी जिम जाते हैं, तो मैं देखता हूँ कि सब प्रोटीन्स लेते हैं और लेकिन उन प्रोटीन्स के बारे में उनको पता ही नहीं होता कि वो प्रोटीन उनके बॉडी को फायदा कर रहा है कि नहीं कर रहा. तो एग्जैक्टली आपको क्या लेना है क्या नहीं लेना एक बार आप कंसल्ट जरूर करिए, ताकि आपको एग्जैक्टली सिचुएशन मालूम पड़े अपनी बॉडी की कि आपको क्या चीज लेना चाहिए और क्या नहीं. दूसरा चीज जो सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट है जो एज अ स्पोर्ट पर्सन मैं कहूंगा कि प्लीज कोशिश करिए कि मैक्सिमम आप अपना हेल्दी फूड लीजिए, और हेल्दी फूड में अगर ग्रीन वेजिटेरियन ले सकते हैं तो वो ज्यादा बेस्ट है, क्योंकि आपकी कहीं ना कहीं कार्बोहाइड्रेट और प्रोटीन की जो नीड है वो कहीं ना कहीं वेजिटेरियन से और आपके मीट से, आपके मिल्क से बहुत ज्यादा इंटैक्ट, आपकी सारी प्रॉब्लम सॉल्व हो जाती है. तो आप मतलब वास्तविकता में जिए, मतलब रियलिटी में जो चीजें अवेलेबल है अगर आप उस पर लेंगे तो ज्यादा बेनिफिट करेगा, ना कि आप उन चीजें पैकेट फूड्स में ज्यादा. पैकेट फूड्स ले सकते हैं लेकिन वो सेकेंडरी ऑप्शन होना चाहिए कि अगर आपके पास अवेलेबल नहीं है तब आप लीजिए. अदरवाइज कोशिश करिए कि मोस्टली टाइम्स आप ग्रीन वेजिटेरियन पे जाइए. दूसरा चीज कि ऑयली फूड को भी इग्नोर करिए, जितना इग्नोर करेंगे उतना ज्यादा बेनिफिट मिलेगा.
जी बिल्कुल सही कहा मनोज जी आपने. आई थिंक अवेयरनेस और राइट इन्फॉर्मेशन वो बहुत जरूरी है, बिकॉज हम अपनी शरीर के साथ हमें नहीं एक्सपेरिमेंट करना चाहिए, और बहुत सूझबूझ के साथ ही हमें डिसाइड करना चाहिए, ना ही कुछ देख कर और फॉलो करके. एंड हमें द अल्टीमेट गोल इज की हेल्दी न्यूट्रिशियस होलसम डाइट इज द की, एंड देयर इज नो शॉर्टकट टू यू नो अटेन गुड न्यूट्रिशनल स्टेटस. थैंक यू सो मच मनोज जी. So I think Pavitra, if you can elaborate more on the workplace from initiative standpoint, like what could be done, like industry engagement and alliance with the government also to foster and drive this nutrition agenda to strengthen the delivery system.
Yeah, no, I think, first of all, having sessions like this itself, first of all, bringing people from the ecosystem, from the industry, from the education system, from sports, into a platform like this to build awareness. I think this is a fantastic initiative in the first place. But I think other than that, industry bodies, and corporates need to partner together, right? Because if you have to kind of, bring this awareness, spread this awareness and really make an impact to our communities, we will have to partner. And there's a lot of work that we've been doing, with FSSAI, AI, for example, in terms of the programs that we are driving, right, and building awareness to children, you know, in different villages and rural areas. So I think we need to continue to partner, you know, whether it's about creating awareness about, you know, whole grain, we partnered with that, or whether it's about, you know, eating right and what you need to eat is an important piece. I think we need to start working also a lot with schools. I don't know if there's a way to partner with the schooling system as well, because this is something that we have to all collectively join our hands and start working together. It's not one person or one institute or, you know, that can really make a difference. So the more collectively we work together and try to impact, I think it's going to be great. And as corporates, you know, one is of course working with industry, but also spreading the news through our own employees, right? I think that's a very, very important vehicle that we need to continue to drive, because, you know, if you're able to educate, you know, your employees and their ecosystem, you know, that's when change begins, right? Change begins with us, you know? So if you're able to bring about a change in ourselves and our ecosystem, I think we will see a multiplier impact. So yeah, there's a lot more to do, but I'm glad that, you know, the journey has begun, and I'm wishing everybody all the very best. Let's become the multiplying force here.
Yeah, thank you so much. Indeed, agree to what you said. And like, we started the nutrition month with our CII family only. We did the nutrition session for them. We called in physiotherapists and nutritionists to give them, you know, some easy exercise tips, you know, while working on the laptop for your neck, for head. And they thoroughly enjoyed the session. I clicked their pictures and they were very happy. So I think things like that must go on. And this is something which is cyclic and it should happen. So like, we have mutual supplementation of cereal pulse combination. So similarly, this supplementation is required here as well.
And simple things, you know, like breathing, for example. We ignore breathing, you know, and we did a very simple exercise where we asked people that, okay, just tell us, show us how you breathe, right? Whether you, does your stomach swell up or not, right? That simple technique of breathing right, people did not know, you know.
People are doing that in the reverse direction.
Exactly. So simple things like that, how to incorporate, you know, in your daily, you know, lifestyle, you know, it needs to become embedded, you know. So I think these are tips and tools that we can definitely spread and start integrating as a part of our rituals.
Definitely. And I think what you mentioned, to begin this in a multiplication format and continuation. So I again request everyone to sign up for the app and let's begin this journey together and, you know, escalate the agenda to the masses we can. So we'll make the registration open for you, for your family, friends, just cascade it to the max you can, and we'll be happy to have you on board with us. So I think the last question to Dr. Jagmeet Madan, very generic, like on the probiotic intake, how safe is it like on a daily basis consumption? And what are the harms of sugar? And from immunity standpoint, if you can talk about, and also on the fad diets, like people are saying ki diets are available, like paleo diet and this flexitarian diet I just saw in the comment section. So they are there. So what is the solution if we are not there to follow these fad diets? Over to you.
Okay, so Richa, I think probably you combined three questions together. So coming to your question number one about probiotics, including probiotics on a daily basis is a good idea, but we should know what is a probiotic. So, you know, when you set curds at home, it is not a probiotic. A probiotic food is a food which contains a specific strain of, you know, microorganism in a desired quantity, and that desired strength of the microorganism should be available to you when you consume that product, right? So when you say I'm having a probiotic food, so today we FSSAI has guidelines for probiotic foods. The strains are specified, the quantities are specified, the labeling is mandated. So probiotic, any fermented food is not a probiotic. That is one thing which we have to understand. But yes, fermented foods do have a blend of microorganisms, but they are not necessarily having probiotic microorganisms. They may be, you know, there are benefits associated with fermented foods. Like when you consume curd, it's more easy to digest as compared to milk. You know, the calcium is more available because lactose is converted to lactic acid and the acidic medium favors calcium absorption. So they are two different things, you know, which we need to understand scientifically. That is point number one. Like I said, in a regular diet on an everyday basis, to my mind, it's the prebiotic, which I mentioned earlier. And one of the prebiotic is the dietary fiber containing rich foods, you know, which give you a whole lot of those compounds which work as a substrate to favor the growth of desirable microorganisms. So in our everyday foods, we should definitely have a lot of dietary fiber and prebiotic foods. And yes, if we can add a probiotic food-based input, preferably a food-based input on a regular basis, it is a win-win situation. It's like a pre and pro coming together becomes a symbiotic, right? And one thing which also needs to be understood is developing a microflora is not an overnight phenomena. It's not that today I started eating prebiotics and probiotics and tomorrow I will have a good gut microflora. I'm sure I'm making a difference, but it happens over a period of time. And like fitness is a lifelong commitment. So I cannot say after 2 months, if I stop working towards my fitness, I will remain fit forever. No. So similarly, you know, developing your gut microbiota is also a lifelong commitment, and you need to pay attention to your everyday foods. And in the everyday food, if there is a presence of probiotic food, it is to your advantage. Now, coming to the second question was with regards to sugar. So let me straight away put the point in perspective that sugar and salt are actually addictions, okay? The way you train yourself, you will get addicted to the threshold of sugar and salt. That is why today, you know, when a baby is born, for one full year, you know, the recommendation of the IAP is not to give any sugar, any salt to the child. So, you know, when you look at these young kids, they don't miss anything. That means they are not demanding salt and sugar for that 1 year of life. So it is not something which you really need to add to your diet. You get addicted to it the moment, you know, you start weaning the child after 1 year to all the variety of foods, and you start developing a taste for it. So sugar definitely is not a recommendation. You get adequate amount of natural sugar from your food. So as much as possible, we can cut down on our sugar intake. And like Ms. Inoshi also said, that the Eat Right initiative clearly mandates, and I think industry is also coming together to work on HFSS lowering in food. That means high fat, salt, and sugar containing foods need to be drastically reduced in our diet. And we need to have options from industry, which are, you know, foods with low salt content, drastically reduced low salt content, you know, minimal of simple sugars, more emphasis on natural sugars, and good quality fat. So that's the mandate which we should work for a good eating. The third thing about the, you know, the kind of diets which we keep hearing. So it's like, you know, we must develop that ability. So that's what I said, the nutrition literacy is your fundamental right, so that you are in a position to analyze what is placed before you. You know, so these diets will keep on changing. Today is paleo, tomorrow is flexitarian, third day there's another diet. So these terminologies will keep floating. But if you understand the basics of working on quality nutrition, and I gave you the simplest example to tell yourself, are you on the right track or no? What should be the foods which should be a part of your everyday diet? The simplest example is your healthy plate, okay? So if you are closer to your plate, see, most of these diets will restrict certain food groups, you know, will probably tell you to, you know, not eat at a particular time, eat at a, you know, beyond a, or may make drastic changes. But things like this without any understanding have no meaning. So if you are placed before, you know, these kind of, if you are reading more about these diets, please take professional help to understand. as to what these diets are talking about. They are basically playing with the selection of foods, the macronutrient distribution, but you take it on face value and start using it, thinking that you're going to get result. You may not get the desired result and you may end up with some complications. So that is where I think I respect Mr. Manoj, and I give you an applause that, you know, you as a sportsperson has put across to the millennials that fitness, you need to work out, you need to pay attention to your diet, and you must seek professional help. You must seek help from a professionally qualified nutritionist to know what is right, to customize your diet to your need, because each individual is different, each body composition is different, and it cannot be one size fits all. So I think these would be my closing comments. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Madan, as always energizing us and also making us think about things in a very thoughtful manner, because we hear a lot of nutrition advice, but I think being able to understand the implications of the actions we take thereon are extremely important. Thank you so much for bringing that to this conversation. As we arrive at the end of the session, I wanted to ask one final question to Pavitra. You know, this has been a great collaboration with Quaker in this effort in terms of reaching out to a very diverse cohort of stakeholders, you know, sort of going beyond industry, reaching out to youth, millennials. And today we saw sort of the engagement of sports. So sort of, you know, from your end standpoint, where do you see, you know, where we are from an initiative standpoint, thoughts on certain next steps and the continued engagement with, you know, taking this very important message forward, which really creates that ownership that we're able to track and monitor and work collectively. Over to you, Pavitra.
Yeah. No, as I mentioned, Meetu, earlier, I think this step, the very step that, you know, we've all come together in a platform like this is fantastic. Okay. And I think as next steps, the more we can dial up this conversation, the more we can reach out to different industry bodies, you know, and corporates as well, right? There's a lot of work that is already going on with FSSAI, with schools. You know, I think our nutrition team has been, you know, going to different schools and trying to create this kind of awareness and education as well. So I think, you know, as I mentioned, you know, we need to start moving. What this was about mass, you know, awareness. Now we need to start getting into personalized nutrition as well, right? Because different cohorts, different people have very different needs. So how do we start looking at that aspect of it, you know? So from mass and making people understand, because COVID has completely brought in this focus of health and wellness in a very, very different way. I think this is great, and we need to dial that up, but we need to also start getting into personalized nutrition. So I think that would be my top of mind thoughts in terms of, you know, personalized nutrition and apps is a very good way of doing it. We've already got a lot of apps, you know, fitness bands, and, you know, which is actually tracking today's stress levels, your oxygen levels, right, your calories intake, outtake. So I think technology is going to be helping you and will help you in your personalized journey. So I think that's the next phase, the way I see it. But you need to integrate both. It's just not app alone, but, you know, app needs to be read in a particular context, you know. So I think that's going to be the next phase of that journey. And one more thing I did want to mention, what we started in our organization is we started this whole holistic, you know, health assessment, you know, and as Manoji said, right, that first you need to understand what are the gaps, right? If people don't understand what the gaps are, you know, you can get swayed away with a lot of, you know, social media information, you know, what's happening, and therefore following diets and following different patterns, right? So what we have started, and I would, you know, urge everybody to do that, start assessing first, right? Where do you stand? And it's just not health alone from a physical fitness and nutrition perspective, but it's also sleep. It's also about your wellness, right? So how do you start looking at a holistic, you know, and do a holistic assessment of your health, and then taking some of those measures, whether it's through, you know, getting some kind of a help through a consultant or, you know, an expert like a Dr. Madan, I think it's going to be very important, and organizations definitely can facilitate this.
Thank you so much, Pavitra. In fact, I must say that this initiative created for us our own impetus even within CII, where we've been now in discussion with our head of HR to say, how do we do this assessment across all our employees? You know, so I think each organization, yes, sort of, we're doing it in maybe bits and pieces, but like you rightly said, a much more holistic assessment of health, and, you know, especially post-COVID, a lot of colleagues coming back, struggling with various kinds of health-related issues where we need to really take cognizance of this. Again, with that, I really want to thank Quaker for this collaboration and all of our panelists, Dr. Madan, Manojji, Priya, and all of you who have joined us here today. And of course, FSSAI and Anoshi ma'am, who's always standing with us in terms of nudging us, but also sort of giving more energy to the initiatives that we take. And we look forward to taking these further. So all of you participated and who had registered, we will send a link out to each one of you to register on the app. So please sign up. You will then go through an assessment, and then post that you can sign up for, you know, consulting and for advice as well from an expert dietitian. And we hope to partner with you in your continued journey as you look at your own nutrition and wellness. Thank you, all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you once again for the opportunity.
Yeah.
Thank you, Manoj.
To all the attendees, we'll be sharing the link via email also, so that you can cascade it and share it with your family and friends further to join this journey with us. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, Noshi ma'am. Thank you, Jagmeet ma'am. Thank you, Manojji. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
A big round of applause.
Yes. Yeah. He is a great source of inspiration to all of us. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.